Good morning, all of you. First of all, I have to thank the organizers of this global development talk organized by the Nudge Foundation and ENCORE for inviting me. Perhaps I am a misfit in this platform of global experts, but then I thought I should seize this opportunity to represent the people who are outside the development discussions and speak on their behalf from a health perspective. Also on behalf of the healthcare professionals who have chosen to work in difficult areas away from the limelight. I will focus on primary healthcare in neglected areas, especially the tribal pockets, based on my experience in a Swasthya Swaraj Comprehensive Community Health Program in Thomadapur block in Kalahandi district, Odisha, since 2014. Of all the forms of inequalities, inequality in health is the most unjust and inhumane. To understand the truth of this statement of Martin Luther King Jr. and the depth of it, you need to visit the tribal areas of our country, especially where the particularly vulnerable tribal groups live. When we started Swasthya Swaraj 6 years ago, we three daring, enterprising women, not knowing the language in an area with no electricity, no mobile connections, and an area which was a den of malaria, where people frightened us saying, if you drink the water of Kalahandi, or if you even take bath in Thomadapur waters, you will get malaria and die. We have journeyed and come a long way since then. We used to see lots of skin infections, scabies, and fungal infections every day, treated and abandoned by the traditional faith healers, several diarrhea cases with dehydration, malaria everywhere, children dying due to severe malaria on the way to hospital, maternal deaths, TB, severe acute malnutrition, the list goes on. In diarrhea cases, we taught the health workers and the mothers on preparing ORS, and they all learned it very well. They will demonstrate exactly what was taught word by word. But to our surprise, we realized that there's no sugar in the villages to make the home ORS. We taught in nutrition about energy food, high energy food, proteins and minerals and vitamins, and then we realized that oil is a luxury item reserved for occasions of celebrations. It's in this context that we started Swasthya Swaraj, and it was a response to this unjust situation. How do we make a change in this situation? How do we improve the health of the people for whom extreme poverty and deprivation have become part of their lives? Health is determined by various determinants: social, economic, nutrition, literacy, infrastructure, transportation, mobile connectivity, cultural traditions, livelihood. The livelihood patterns of these people are such that the women have no time even for delivering the baby. Then there is the constant struggle for food, drinking water, shelter. The dominant development paradigm in health needs to be revisited and shifted. Disproportionate focus on tertiary and specialized healthcare is at the cost of primary healthcare, which should be the bedrock of any health system. When healthcare is moving towards higher and higher specialization and becoming expensive day by day, who will provide healthcare to the poor of this country? How will the poor access healthcare when it is concentrated in urban areas and metropolitan cities? How will the poor get good health care? The sad thing is that more than 70% of our people require only primary health care. Tackling the health care challenges in tribal areas. Swasthya Swaraj views the challenges experienced by the tribal community not as a whole, but instead as components. This allows us to identify smaller segments that can be tackled with strengths that we have in an incremental way, in a comprehensive way. when it comes to tackling the healthcare needs in tribal areas, there's some factors to be considered. Number one is availability. This is ensuring availability of healthcare personnel, doctors, nurses, and paramedics who have to be available and willing to work in the backward poor areas. Where doctors do not go, nurses also do not go. Healthcare is a teamwork, manpower and resources have to be there. Second is accessibility. If a mother has to walk more than 10 kilometers carrying her sick child, she would rather choose not to go to a hospital, whatever good quality healthcare is provided there. If it involves staying away from her work, leaving the other children uncared for, she wouldn't go. Accessibility also includes road infrastructure, availability of public transport, mobile network, energy supply in the villages. We need to make sure who are the most vulnerable groups and whether they are able to access the healthcare, not just the numbers in the health center. This may include very often that we take the trouble to reach out to where they are, which is very hard. 40 years after Alma-Ata declaration, the Indian health system's approach continues to rely on population-based norms, 100,000, 30,000, 10,000, etc., which is okay in non-tribal areas. But this population-based norms has little consideration for aspects like quick access, acceptability and community participation. Third factor is affordability. Who will bear the cost of treatment? The poor cannot bear the cost. In Swasthya Swaraj, we provide free of cost all investigations and treatment. The poor coming in contact with the health system for the first time cannot afford the cost of consultation, nursing care, medicines and investigations. Also, their nutrition is of equal importance as much as medicines. Supplementary nutrition is part of therapy in our setting. The fourth factor is community participation. Unlike in secondary and tertiary healthcare settings, primary healthcare is the healthcare of the community. Community has to be empowered to meaningfully participate in the healthcare. For this, we need to empower the different cadres of the society. People are not just passive recipients of healthcare, but they have to be empowered to be actively participating in the healthcare. How do we empower the community to participate in primary healthcare program? Swasthya Swaraj model is, we train different categories of people. One, Swasthya Sathis. We are the frontline healthcare workers. In every village and every hamlet, one tribal woman is trained and is being trained who is usually illiterate. Second is community health practitioners who are the mid-level health workers. These are educated tribal girls belonging to PVTG groups. Third is training of traditional birth attendants. Then fourth is field animators. These are educated tribal youth who are in charge of 6 to 8 villages or hamlets. Then number five is the adolescent girls' empowerment and improvement of their nutrition in order to reduce the low birth weight babies and intergenerational stunting. Then children as educators of the community. This is an intervention in government primary schools using agriculture as a medium of education. Also, there is a TB program, which is a comprehensive TB control program addressing the various aspects of TB care in collaboration with the government. Then the malaria control, also in collaboration with the government. Malaria in under 5 children and in pregnant women are special targets. What are the results we have seen so far? By measurable indicators, reduced the malaria from 55% positivity in 2015-16 to less than 10% in 18-19. Malaria in pregnancy decreased from 35% to 7% during this period. Infant mortality rate is down from 152 per 1,000 live births in 2014-15 207,000 live births in 2018-19. Child mortality rate is down from 258,000 to 127,000 live births. Neonatal deaths remain the same, 65% of the infant mortality rate. TB detection is improved, which means the infectivity reduces in the community. And TB cure rates is increased considerably. Undernutrition rates is coming down. Underweight children, that's weight for age, numbers decreased considerably from 73% in 2014-15 to 49%. These figures may have many fallacies, as estimating the age of the baby and date of birth was a huge challenge, as no mother knew the age of the baby. But stunting rates remain the same, around 63%, not only in the under 5 children, but also in children 6 years to 13 years, indicating chronic and intergenerational undernutrition. In conclusion, if you ask me what is the single best intervention which will make the most results, my answer is focus on primary health care and primary education. Improve the quality and the quantity of it with determination and commitment. We need healthcare professionals coming forward to work in four areas. For this, revamping medical education system and producing more doctors and nurses have not proven to be solving the problem. Our urban areas and some states of the country have already doctor population ratio 1:100 and is on par with the United States and advanced countries. But in states like Odisha, it is 1:7,000 plus, and when you come to tribal areas, it may be 1:20,000 to 30,000. But remember one thing, it's not doctors or healthcare professionals who make the change. It is people themselves. We will be achieving SDGs in good health and well-being only when people in the community, instead of remaining as passive recipients of healthcare services, come to the realization that health is their right and they start demanding healthcare. A primary care healthcare physician and facilitate this process. As health and nutrition go hand in hand, we need to simultaneously concentrate on nutrition. Our present PDS program alleviates starvation deaths, but we need to make the people demand and get PDS, not just for hunger alleviation, but for improving their nutrition status by including oil and pulses in it in the tribal area. This is the paradigm shift in primary health care. Healthcare not as service, but as a right of the people. But this is a slow process. Rudolf Virchow said, if deprivation is the root cause of disease, then doctors are the natural attorneys of the poor. Yes, more doctors need to be motivated and encouraged to use their skills in the poor localities too. Doctors are trained to diagnose, to find the root cause of diseases. In primary health care, we need to use these skills to diagnose the root cause of problems, not only of individual diseases, but also of the community, and the community can immensely benefit from this competence. When we work for the poor, the program cannot be self-sustaining. You need external funding support. I would like to conclude with a quotation from Karl Marx. If we have chosen the position in life in which we can most of all work for mankind, no burdens can bow us down. Our happiness will belong to millions. Our deeds will live on quietly, but perpetually at work. Thank you.